my topic today is going to be about becoming data-driven. So how many of you have that as a target for yourself or your organizations? I guess most. Who wouldn't? I want to introduce you to two fictional characters. This is Lisa and Michael. And while they are fictional, they're sort of based on leaders in the industry that we stumble upon frequently. One of them is being successful at becoming data-driven, and one of them isn't. And we're going to get back to them really soon. My name is Emma Storbacka. I'm the CEO of Avaus, and I've been working with data and technology for the past 15 years, and it's really a true passion for me. When we work with corporations looking to become more data-driven, what the leaders come to us and ask is, how do we become data-driven? What is that? And the answer to this question is somewhat simple, yet extremely complicated. But what I typically say is that there's two things you need to sort of focus on. And the first thing is the more strategically difficult. It's becoming customer-centric. Now, if you want to learn about customer centricity, who should you turn to? Where should you look for inspiration? I would look here. This is the most customer-centric company in the world. And funnily enough, they are entering the Nordic market as we speak. So what is Amazon doing to be so customer-centric? Well, one of their leadership principles is that customers come first, and then you backtrack from there to do all of the other things. And that's a pretty hard thing to do. Most of the organizations that we work with and are present here in the room and on the live stream are product companies. You plan, you budget, you staff, you organize yourself around what sort of products you have. You launch campaigns, you do your yearly budgeting and business planning based on what products you're going to launch or what new features you're going to launch. And what is Amazon doing then? Well, they start with the customers. Yesterday, I got the first indication that Amazon is here. I got an Instagram ad for Amazon Prime Video. So why are Amazon addressing me with an ad for Amazon Prime Video? What we see in the media is only Amazon as, you know, the bookstore killer, or Amazon the web shop platform for small businesses. But Amazon is so much more than that. And Amazon is built on data. So why not advertise the coming web platform and Black Friday and whatnot to me, but rather advertise their subscription service for videos? Well, because that's the best way and the most likely way to make me a registered Amazon customer, which also means that I start pouring data into their systems. So what else is Amazon? Well, they are a web shop with tons of personalized touch points, but not only product recommendations, it's also the search, it's when they communicate to you, how they communicate to you, in which channels, and about what. Also, what type of recommendations, or for example, what do you call them? The reviews that people have been leaving. All of that is tailored to me as an individual with the data that I'm pouring into Amazon. Amazon also has other touch points. They have a whole book and digital reading service. There's Amazon Prime, which is a subscription service that adds you into their fantastically designed loyalty program, which means that you will never get out and you will start collecting more and more of your sort of online and offline behavior into Amazon. Amazon Prime Video is, of course, one of the sort of entry points into that. Amazon Alexa will come into our homes and it will start collecting also unstructured data from our lives. Amazon Go is a retail experience where you don't even have to talk to anyone. You just go in, grab your stuff and walk out, and they do facial recognition to connect whatever you took to your credit card. Amazon is so good at working with data that they even sell you that algorithm back. So you can use Amazon's algorithms to personalize your own experiences. So Amazon entering the Nordics is not just about the web platform. It's about teaching all of us that we need to compete on a completely different level, because our consumers or customers, B2B and B2C, will sort of get used to this reality sooner than we might think is even possible. Now, can we become Amazon? No. It simply is not possible for a long list of reasons that I won't go into here. But you can learn from Amazon's way of working with data and working with customers from a customer-first perspective. And I would want to claim that actually being data customer-centric is all about being data-centric. And that is one of the things that Amazon is doing so well, and where all of us in the European sort of sphere need to kind of ramp up our capabilities quite fast in order to be customer-centric. I won't talk that much more about data, because I actually did my full presentation on the last Avaus expert talks in the spring, the week that the corona actually hit in Helsinki. But I will leave you with one insight from that presentation that you can see on YouTube, and that is, forget about the customer 360. So if all of what I said until now made you go, yeah, we have the 360 project, so we're covered, that is the one thing that is most likely to make you fail. So the customer 360 is sort of a doomsday for becoming data-driven. If you want to learn why, you can see the presentation on YouTube. So when you do have that data in place, it's all about how you activate it. And we'll hear from some of the speakers today about the topic of activation. And when you try to understand what data activation really means, we've developed this very simple framework called data algo action. So basically describing use cases for what data you should take, how you will add more intelligence, and how you will automate actions across channels. And this is to make a fairly difficult topic more tangible for all of us to work with, educate our peers, our bosses, our team members on. And when we started looking at, well, what are some typical data algo action frameworks, kind of applications, we actually made a cookbook. And those of you here in the room can take one in physical print, which is pretty rare. I think that's a great coffee table book. And those of you online can visit the avaus.com/cookbook and download it. And we can even snail mail one of the printed ones to you if you just send me an email or DM on LinkedIn. So there's 50 use cases of data algo action in that book. Well, what many organizations then look at is, okay, that's very inspirational. Ah, I learn a lot. But where do I start? What we say is, it doesn't really matter where you start. It's how you scale that matters. And that's the question that you should be asking. And for many, it's such a new topic. And data literacy is really a challenge for understanding all of this. So when I went to the team this summer and said, how do we explain all of this? How do we explain the scalability of data algo action put into place for a sort of fictional organization? They came back with something that I'm super proud to show you now. This is the first MVP, but it's sort of a visualization of, in a way, what your reality should look like, maybe today or maybe a few years from now. And it's at least a visualization of what it looks like for Amazon. So we call this the nexus. And if you imagine all of the different data points that you might have in your organization, so they might be digital or physical, they might be structured or unstructured, but you have all of the different data sources on the left-hand side. And then you have all of the different activation channels on the right-hand side. And then you start thinking about, how do I add intelligence here in between with algorithms that are deciding what I should do in each channel, or even which channel to use? And then when you take into account that this sort of shows the data flows of one customer only, in real time, activated in all of your channels, so not only the digital ones, then you start to realize that this is incredibly complex, which means that you have to automate. We can't think about having, you know, a person deciding on all of those different streams. We have to put automation into place. And that is why Amazon is able to be customer-centric, although they have so many customers. And this is a actually interactive tool that we've created. So in order to be able to explain or maybe internally visualize what you're trying to achieve here, what we sort of start realizing when we look at this, and these are kind of important insights. One really important thing is that you probably are going to want to work with both your online and offline data. So that's a really critical thing. It doesn't matter that it's 360. It could be only 2% or 2 degrees of your full data, possible data sources. But you're going to want to choose the ones that have the biggest predictive power going into an algorithm. You'll also start realizing that an algorithm that only has one string to, you know, one channel or one campaign is not being optimally utilized. So it's really about scaling to all kinds of channels with that same intelligence. And then you realize that in order to manage all of this, most of the things on the right-hand side need to be automated. So this is a completely new world for sales, marketing, and customer experience. And this goes for both B2B and B2C. So the question really that you should be asking yourself, or that your boss maybe is asking but doesn't know how to pose that question, is not sort of how data-driven are we, but sort of what is our automation level? And that should be, in a way, the leading thinking behind your quest to become data-driven. So if we go back to Lisa and Michael here, you can see that on the right-hand side, Michael is not being so successful. So he's been doing some initial data algo action thinking, and he's getting some of the things in place. Whereas Lisa has been able to scale up with many different data sources, activated in many different action channels, and there's this sort of real-time thinking behind that. So how do you get here? What's the difference between their approaches? Some of the reasons that I wanted to show you why this might be going in the wrong direction, and they all have to do with one topic, and that is operational efficiency. And that's sort of the boring part. You know, customer centricity and omnichannel customer experience, that's sexy, and that's, you know, new technologies, and you can talk about AI, and you can buy nice softwares and stuff. But really, when it comes down to whether you're successful or not, it's sort of if you have that production line thinking that you would have your colleagues in supply chain management or in operations management would. And that's the sort of thinking that we're quite often lacking when it comes to data, digital, marketing, sales. Process and efficiency thinking. So some of the things that might be going wrong, and you might recognize some of this, these are things that Michael are doing. One thing is that he's focusing on low-hanging fruits, and he's focusing on that for too long. So I really like this saying of being agile is not an excuse for the lack of the strategy. If you have a feeling that you're spending a year on low-hanging fruits, then probably you're not going to get to the target state that you've been driving for. Another mistake that we see happening quite often, and that Michael is sort of guilty of, is emphasizing too much the sort of human part of the puzzle. Do you know who this is? This is Garry Kasparov. He's a world-renowned chess master, and he's the one who got defeated by IBM supercomputer some 10, 15 years ago. And he wanted to sort of learn what the sort of optimal combination between human and machine is. And what he learned is that actually what matters the most is the process. So if you have a weak human, or not a very good chess player and a machine, and an excellent chess player and a machine, what will really matter is whether or not the process of how you take those insights and apply them into actions is what matters. And I would say that this goes also with the whole digital area. Which brings us to the last part, which is blaming the technology and the data capabilities. So according to some research done by MarTech Today, kind of a whopping 82% of all surveyed marketing leaders actually switched out some core piece of their marketing technology in the last year. And typically those would not even be the sort of small things, it would be kind of business critical systems like CRM and marketing automation. And that's, I think, a case of probably having extremely competent people having a poor process, getting not enough results, and switching out the machine instead of focusing on the process. So I think we're overly emphasizing the technology here and focusing too little on how do you sort of scale this in an efficient way. So I have four things that I want to leave with you in order to kind of learn from Lisa and other leaders who are able to scale up their activities. The first thing is to go with a business case first approach. So you have to start with what is it that we're trying to achieve here? And you have to go wide. You can't go only with the first low-hanging fruit and trying to calculate the value of that, but really looking at when we have automated at scale, when we have our nexus, when we are activating data across all channels, what sort of the business benefit we're going for here? How will this impact both our top line and our bottom line? And are there additional benefits that we might be creating? And you need to sort of be able to put this in a CFO language. And that's very uncomfortable for marketers, especially. But you have to make this happen. Because otherwise, when you take the next step and start looking at what is actually the target automation level, how many use cases or sort of data algo action processes do we want to have in place, you're going to aim too low. And they're not going to sort of match together. So you might be investing in data and technology and resources, but you're actually not realizing the work that you need to put into it. So I would say that for a typical sort of large enterprise, your automation target level in the first step should probably be 200, 300, 400 automated processes across marketing, sales, and service as a starting point. And then when you start calculating, like how long does it take for me to create one of those automated processes? Is it going to be 15 days, 30 days, 50 days, 150 days per automated process? Then you start finding sort of the levers that you need to play with in order to actually get to this point. Too many organizations, I would say, is expecting all of this automation to happen at the side of your operational daily duties in sales and marketing and customer experience and customer service, for instance. And that simply won't happen. So it's a question of staffing. And when you take into account the fact that there's a really big risk of you also not getting this done because people are caught up with doing whatever happens in life, you need to sort of hedge that with the way that you actually set your targets, define the roadmap of use cases, which is in the hundreds, and then actually lead the production of those. The two last things are then about leadership. So one is keeping yourself and your team accountable for business results. And unless you have a KPI framework or a reporting framework that allows you to do that really in a good way and in a customer-centric way, it's very likely that you won't be able to show that that big business case and all of those automated processes are actually delivering on what you promised. So that's sort of a key capability you need to have, and you need to commit to it. And you need to start measuring things like throughput times or average delivery times. And that's very new for most of us. But that's the only way that you will be able to scale. And then last, but definitely not least, you have to be extremely comfortable with the leadership aspect. You have to dare to lead this transformation. And you also have to be comfortable with the fact that you're learning all the time. This is my last slide. I think these are extremely important topics. If we don't manage to do this, there are lots of companies like Amazon and Alibaba's and the Tencents of the world happy to do it instead of us. So we are caring a lot about this topic. That's why we give away a lot of content on our website, in webinars and in the expo booths and so on. So do take part in those. We've also standardized a way to get to that, but that's sort of a lesser issue. We believe that for European competitiveness and for us to have a chance in this sort of increasingly digitalized world with increasing global competition, we don't really have a choice but to actually make this happen in all of our organizations. So let's together take the algo leap. Thanks for being here today. Let's spend a day learning things from each other and sharing and asking. And let's go back and make awesome things happen. Thank you.